I'll be back with the whole fire department.
War in Asia, but only slightly less well known is this. Never go in against a Sicilian when death is on the line.
Death and dismemberment. And
it's maybe controversial. I want to start off the show with a firestorm of controversy.
That, right.
Not a big fan of Princess Bride. Yeah.
We got some controversy coming.
I need to see it again.
The first half, I think, is just absolutely brilliant. I do think it gets kind of slow and sort of silly.
I remember everybody talking about it at the time, and I saw it when it was on HBO. So this would have been like the year after it came out.
Right.
And I remember just thinking, it didn't do it for me. But I'd like to see it with older eyes and see if I feel any different about it now that it is a cultural institution.
Well, you're welcome to borrow it, because I have like every iteration of it, because I happen to like it. Again, I have problems with like the last 45 minutes of it.
Well, I would be happy to not pay to see it.
Well, there you go.
And you are?
I'm Tom.
Oh, and I'm Mark.
And who are we?
The Cinemaniacs. Hey, how are you?
Sort of.
We're the Sicamaniacs, actually. If you watched last week's...
I'm the Getting Better Maniac.
You're going to see both sides of the Death Valley here, because he was sick last week, sounding very sultry. Very Lauren Bacall-esque, shall we say. I'm upping it from Brenda Vaccaro.
They're all women.
Well, you know...
Mercedes McCambridge, Exorcist.
What's his name? David Doyle? I don't know if that resonates with people anymore. I've got it now, so the more I talk, the less oxygen that goes to my constricted airways.
Well, they'll appreciate
that.
And the more
lightheaded I get, so this will be fantastic. So we have, yet again, sort of a light show this week in terms of content and load, as it were. So would you care, as you are the less sick of the two of us, would you care to expend your brain waves on what we're going to talk about?
I will handle the elephant's share of the work. I don't know what the relationship might be. But lovely Emma Watson is back with her dulcet bell-like tones. Oh, that's a joke. I hadn't even thought about that. And she's got some problems because Dad's in prison and she has to save him and deal with a really big, brutish, hulking, ugly guy. But let's face it, it's a Disney film, and true love resounds when we take a look at Beauty and the Beast.
Whatever your choice from the snack bar, things go better with Coke.
Hi.
Oh, okay, just quick. Here we go. Shall I begin since you let you?
I'm so weak.
Okay, he's so weak. As are his opinions. Sorry, just got to get that jab in there. Anyway, clearly based, taken straight from the animated Beauty and the Beast, which I think is hugely popular, particularly among the young ladies. I'm going to cough, actually, even though I don't feel that bad. I have to throw this in there. I smiled. It started on a great note, because as the lights were going down, and it was, I saw it Sunday at a 3:30 version, so it, like, one or two other versions had already been playing that day. It was packed. There were people buying tickets for later, so this is going to do huge box office, which, you know, I think is great. There aren't that many family films out there, and I think this is, I mean, it's Disney, clearly perfectly available for the family. But what I'm getting at was, lights were going down, hard to find a place. I heard some little girl go, "Mommy, Mommy, up front." So she went up front, and she had her whole Belle costume on. The big flowing veil. I just laughed. I thought it was great.
Did she walk up and down the aisle, and you could hear it go, shh, shh, shh.
You could hear it. Actually,
that's fantastic.
It was very funny. So anyway, based on the animated Beauty and the Beast, which is, what, 20 years old or something like that probably. I don't remember. I was never crazy about that version. There are a lot of Disney ones that I really like, some old, some new. This one didn't do a whole lot for me. So I went into this kind of thinking, strangely enough, here's one that we're paying in more ways than one.
We're paying in soul dollars.
Paying our duty to see this film so we can review it. I love Emma Thompson. Emma Watson. Emma Thompson, strangely enough, is in it as well. We can make Harry Potter jokes. But I love Emma Watson. I think she's wonderful. It took me a little while because the the buildings and things almost look a little bit, it reminded me of Harry Potter. And it took me a little time to get used to her. I still think, and for some reason I have issues, particularly with actresses, and I don't know why this is. I don't think I'm being misogynist or something, but I can't lose them in the characters as much. I see Emma Watson. Anyway, liked her a lot. Basically going into this thinking, not crazy about the story. Let's see what this will happen. I thought the songs were fun. The first song seems to go on for like half an hour. I don't know if it did that in the original.
I don't remember.
I'm ultimately not going to get down on this picture, but I left with kind of thinking, I don't really care a whole lot about it. I don't remember enough about the original animated film to make comparisons to it. But I found our main bad guy, Gaston. They make some silly joke about him not understanding French, wherein I think he's French. There were lots of little things here that just took me out and made me think, this movie doesn't really come together real well. I didn't care about most of the characters. I thought it was very formulaic. And, you know, give me a break. It's Beauty and the Beast, okay? You know they're going to fall in love and everything at the end. But it started out to where I thought, and for those of you who know the story, I'm not sure if this was in the original film, the animated film, but I kind of think this curse that is laid upon the Beast guy, who is a prince early on, is perfectly deserved. Hey, you deserve that. Take that. But later on, so he kind of wins us over and obviously wins Belle over. And I can deal with the fact that he has this character arc. What bothered me the most, two things, and I hate to say this, but I really kind of left with thinking this was about a 5 for me out of 10. Not crazy about it at all. One was the unbelievable nearly, I will bet that almost every single shot had CG in it, particularly the backgrounds. We see Belle and she's running around the, what looked to me like a 20-foot set and the rest of the background is CG. And it just really stood out to me. A main character is all CG. Why? I don't get it. And also, I remember that Emma Watson has sung. We've heard her voice singing in other films. I can't remember what it was. But her voice, particularly early on, sounded very auto-tuned, very much like it was manipulated.
I'm sure it was.
So the technique, the technology behind this, particularly for a Disney film, really stood out to me more than any of the others, and I ended up not being crazy about it.
So we entered the theater separately, but on similar paths.
Oh, really? Okay.
I went to see this on a Friday noon matinee.
Okay.
I'd worked more than 40 hours that week, so that 2 hours out of my time, if anybody, you know. Just saying. Very healthy audience.
Yeah.
Of all ages for the first showing of the day on, you know, on Friday. And they were all into it a lot, which was cool. My history of Beauty and the Beast is similar. I didn't care about it when it was in theaters as a cartoon. I'd seen the original French black and white wonderful version on TV as a kid and really liked that. Highly recommend that, by the way. I think Criterion has that out. And it's been done over and over and over again over the years.
Right.
I eventually saw it on tape and I was like, eh. And I saw it again when it played as a theatrical re-release, the Disney animated version. And right. I again was... Yeah, I don't really care about this movie that much. But for a lot of people of a certain age, it is their Cinderella. It
right.
is their masterpiece. So there are a lot of who's going to see this. So I went in not caring. I went in thinking, I have to sit through this.
Right.
Well, let's get it out of the way during the day. I wound up actually liking it quite a bit, surprisingly.
Really? Okay.
I don't remember the animated version well enough to tell you how beat for beat this is similar. But
right.
from what I remember, it's very similar. I'm very curious. Because the animated film was such a huge hit, and because The Lion King on Broadway was a huge hit, there was then a musical version
right.
of Beauty and the Beast based on the Disney animated film. I'd like to know how much of elements that were created for that Broadway
yeah,
play were brought into this, because that opening musical number that's in the little village, the way it's staged and performed feels mm-hmm. very Broadway, which in general I'm not a fan of, which in the beginning of the film I was worried. I'm like, I don't care for Disney-style musical song stylings, and I don't care for Broadway musical style song stylings and performances.
Okay.
I'm sick. mentally. So I was worried this movie was going to be a chore to sit through. But I found the cast very charming and effective. It was beautifully shot. I loved the sets and all of that stuff. The CG in the environment didn't bother me very much. But I do question, why is the Beast CGI?
Right.
You know, in the original film of Beauty and the Beast in the 40s, it's a guy with makeup, and it's effective. You think that is a creature. Or have we gone so far? Is it really cheaper? Because Hollywood is all about doing it, biggest return on your investment, smallest investment, biggest return. Is it really cheaper to create, to have armies of technicians creating a CG character than just doing some, paying a good makeup artist or 10 to do that? I'd really love to know why they didn't do it that way. Because to me, it was far more distracting to go, well, his lips don't quite match. And when he walks up the stairs, he seems to float a bit. I wouldn't be taken out of the movie if it was just a guy. And there are some CG wolves that are fake because they're fake.
But also, and I wanted to throw in there since you brought it up right now, was I think this is perfectly appropriate for young kids, with the possible exception of that. I thought that was pretty frightening.
I did want to, that's why I brought that up. Okay. That there is a sequence where a main character or two are terrorized by wolves, scary wolves in the night.
Yeah.
And it's pretty intense. Now, I don't believe that a child should ever be frightened by anything in their childhood because, frankly, when you grow up, for me, that's the stuff you look back on and go, oh my God, that scared me so much when I was a kid, and you laugh about it. Fear is an element of life. They're not going to jump out of the screen. Although if you see it in 3D, maybe they will jump out of the screen. I did not see this in 3D.
Nor did I.
But I felt in watching it that there were probably quite a few sequences that would have looked nice in 3D.
I thought there were a few sequences that forced itself into 3D. There's a bit where Belle is getting ready for this ball that she's going to have with the Beast. And it's probably a 45-second sequence where all of this gold takes this time and comes down and decorates her dress.
Yeah.
And oh my God, I've got, really? Bore me to death.
You were not wrapped up in the love and magic of Beauty.
I guess not.
Let's address the, I can't use the words I want to use because it's not 10 o'clock yet on our channel.
Oh, okay.
Let's address the totally bogus controversy that was going on around this movie.
Yes.
Okay. And we haven't talked about it yet because we didn't feel it was appropriate, but this film is nonstop hardcore gay male sex. No! All that crap that people are like, oh my God, there's a gay character and blah, 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 and the agenda
like
and all
Germany's
this other stuff.
Banned this or something.
There's a theater that refused to show it and all that stuff, and it's like, you know, hats off for the one-handed salute there. This is so stupid. There's there is a character that is likely of the gay persuasion in the film. It's not the character everybody was talking about. The content, if you looked really hard for it, is maybe there for a total of 4 seconds in the movie. Because they're like, oh, two men dance together. And I'm like, yeah, that is presented as an amusing accident at the end of the movie.
Right.
Literally does not last 2 seconds on screen. Just people need to get over themselves and wake up and figure out what century it is, frankly. So if you're not going to go see this movie that I thought was rather wonderful, and this is a guy who didn't want to see it because of that stuff, you're not too bright. Beauty and the Beast, I quite liked it. I think that Disney is sort of two for two for me with the let's remake all of our animated classics in live action because we're scared that somebody might not want to go see a movie that they've never heard of. Up next is a live-action Dumbo directed by Tim Burton.
Really?
You think they're going to use actual elephants?
Yeah. Oh, I'm sure.
What's funny to me is these live-action films are going to have such a huge element of contemporary animation that they're still half-animated movies anyway. But anyway.
Before we get away from Beauty and the Beast, your axiom of never make reference to a better movie came up twice for me. Did you make relative reference to the Sound of Music shot?
I did notice that.
Okay.
It
so
felt like
Belle
that.
Is coming up.
I'm like, don't spin.
But no, she's coming up on this big hill that overlooks the town and the camera swoops down and there's grass all over and I'm going, oh my God, it's Sound of Music. And then, and this is getting super picky, but because it's one of my favorite films, during one of the songs that Beast is singing, he's talking about, oh, I'm going to love you, blah, 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 come what may. And then, oh, there's Moulin Rouge for me. So not that.
Oh, see, I don't know the Moulin.
Okay, so, but we love, my younger son thought that that took him out, so. But anyway, I thought the Sound of Music shot was, because that wasn't Disney, so. You know, it's not like poking fun at your own self or anything. So anyway, I'm not intentionally trying to get down on Beauty and the Beast. If this was the only version that ever came out, I think I'd probably bump it up a couple of points. But once again, I'm looking for something new. And boy, for me, the effects and CG and stuff really took its toll. I don't think the vast majority of people are going to care about that. So I think, you know, overall, this is certainly a perfectly good family film.
And I think it will make a ton of money.
Oh, my gosh, yes.
And it has been publicly stated that it will be locally at Keene Cinemas for a month.
For the rest of the year,
now,
right.
And you know, how much of that is them knowing it's going to do well, and how much of that is Disney saying, if you want anything, you will
right,
play
you better
this for a month.
Right, exactly.
Which is probably almost more the latter than the former. Speaking of films for the whole family.
Oh, yes, please
involving
do.
Involving ladies and children and mothers and childs and things like that. We have a new film. This is kind of interesting. This is the modern era we live in, folks. This is coming out in theaters this Friday, and also debuting exclusively on Shudder, which is the horror-only streaming movie service that you can get through your computers and TVs and things like that. We have the story of a woman who is instructed to do very, very terrible things by the unborn baby in her belly. In a film, a dark, oh so dark comedy entitled Prevenge.
So another one you got for us. This one was kind of bizarre, I thought.
Yeah, this was a bit of an odd duck. It's a bit of brilliant Ballyhoo promotion for this movie recently because it's opening like this week. There are certain theaters that were doing free screenings for pregnant women.
Is that right?
I mean, not screenings to tell if you're pregnant, but
right.
free screenings
okay,
of this
okay.
film for ladies who were with child, which is just, boy, what an odd movie to watch if you've got something living in you.
Right.
So the story of this film is this woman is being told to kill by the unborn baby in her stomach. And
she doesn't have any 666s on her or anything.
No, like that, so. No. And basically the backstory, it was a little unclear to me. It all becomes mostly clear by the end, is that the person who was the father of the child had died in a mountaineering accident, and she was enacting revenge on, I hope this isn't a spoiler, she was enacting revenge for the death of this guy on all the other people who were involved in that
right.
accident. And it's basically her, you know, seducing these various oddball guys and then offing them in pretty violent ways. But it's not just the guys, it's other people she meets in
right.
life too, who her baby tells her are bad people. So it almost feels like a Son of Sam kind of thing.
Sort of, okay. I can see that.
Alice Lowe, who's writer, director, star of this movie, was apparently 7 months pregnant while making the movie. And I read that after the fact and I'm like, wow, she did some physical stuff in this movie that I'd be worried about somebody
right.
about to pop doing that. I recognize her. I can't tell you specifically from what, but if you watch a lot of British TV comedy, she's in a lot of various things. I think some sketch comedy shows she was in that I saw. She's good with the drama. Like a lot of British comedians, they're good with the drama, they're good with the comedy.
Right.
This is advertised as more of a comedy than I think it really is. It was funny
yeah.
at times, but
it had dark humor. But
it was also pretty creepy and gruesome and I don't know if touching is the right word, but there were some emotional things going on that I wasn't laughing at. So
right.
I would say when you know horror comedy, I would put the comedy in all lowercase. It's much more of a horror thriller. At times it makes you wonder if what you're seeing is real or not, and at times it is pretty funny. I don't know. It's pretty sick and twisted, but I quite enjoyed Prevenge myself.
Sick and twisted might be. I didn't see that up there with all the Palms d'Or
no.
or anything like
predictably
that.
Predictably brilliant.
I usually cringe when I see the Palms d'Or. I usually cringe when I see a film that's written, directed, acted, boomed, you
Me
know,
too, yeah.
dolly gripped by the same person. But I thought Lowe was really good in this, and I enjoyed, and does this have anything to do with the film? Probably not. But I enjoyed knowing that how completely involved she was in this. I'm not familiar with her, but I thought she was really good in this, so I thought performances overall were fun. It took me a while to get around the kind of bizarre nature of it, and to try to figure out whether is she nuts or is this truly like paranormal or something like that. So I won't give away too much with that. overall, I was a little, not that I knew anything about this going in. Once we kind of figured out, and you already made reference to the fact that the reason she's killing all these people is kind of revenge for her husband. I thought that was a little, I wanted more. Maybe from the film, I thought the film was better, could have been better than that. But overall, I thought Prevenge is one of these things that kind of slides in here originally. I thought it was, and you know, can you say you enjoyed watching it when it's as grim and dark as it is? No. But for what it was, I thought it was certainly among the better of, you're right, I think it's more, certainly more horror. But we've got lots of horror and comedy that work together. You know, American Werewolf in London and those kinds of things. I put that up, you know, close to that caliber. I thought it was unusual, but a lot of fun.
This is another for the, see, I'm using old terminology, at the video store.
Right.
This is for that very thin shelf of, you know, maternity horror.
Maternity horror.
It's like, you know, Rosemary's Baby, okay, right, yeah. Daddy's Got a Hunting in this.
Right.
So we have one more to discuss that is in some theaters somewhere.
Right. Somewhere along the line you might be able to pick up. T2 it's called. No, Arnold is not back. But Ewan McGregor is back. And he spent a couple of decades across the pond, familiarizing himself with American culture and things like that. But he decides to go back and visit all of his buddies. It's T2, Trainspotting.
Hi.
So, do you remember the original well?
I saw the original in Keene when it came out.
Okay. I think, and not to steal your thunder, but as you and I were talking,
please.
What I was struck with was, I remember it taking me half an hour to understand them. They sound like they're much more understandable now, but that's just my ear. But also that it was a movie full of not reprehensible characters. They're not bad people. They're just, no pun intended, on the wrong track. And so that makes it difficult for me to root for them. It's like, in some respects, it's a Goodfellas about drugs, in that there's nobody respectable in Goodfellas, and so that's right. One of the problems. As much as I understand and respect it as a film, I didn't like it. I didn't like the characters. So I had the same feeling about Trainspotting. Big Ewan McGregor fan. I'm looking forward to seeing this, but I haven't.
No, we couldn't. It's not in town.
Sorry.
And neither of us, we were both too busy and or ill to travel this weekend to see anything. So if you've seen T2, and let's just clear this up, you can't call it
T2. Yeah, how can you call it T2?
You just can't. Anybody who's of a certain age, right. And maybe they don't give a crap about those people anymore,
it's
but
the
people
train.
Of that age are the people, exactly. Right. The people of that age are the people who would have seen Trainspotting. You can't call it T2.
Right.
If you've seen T2 and you want to let us know what you thought of it, email us at movies@CheshireTV.org, and we will honest to goodness read it. Out loud on a train.
Mm.
So that's all that we have to discuss that is currently theatrical.
Yes.
Now we move on to that which is home video, in whatever format you choose.
However
to
you may get it.
Ingest videos at home. And if I may.
Did you just call them videots?
Videos.
Oh, okay.
Videos. There was a renowned LA video store that just shuttered its doors called Vidiot's.
Sure, I used to frequent it.
Oh, really? Mm-hmm. This is a huge place, and even they were not able to hold on in the face of our current sad state of affairs. So, first up, Oscar-nominated film with a cast of faces, actually pretty small faces. Not the Rod Stewart, Ronnie Wood band. Right. No, this is a small cast of faces you would recognize in a tale of a working man's struggles to stay afloat and stay above board in all aspects of his life, despite being separated by fences.
Aluminum and wood fence in a wide variety of styles and colors, including chain link fence for commercial and residential.
Some people do.
And when he beats his father to death
with that bat,
extra long and sturdy stick of celery. So this nominated for Academy Awards for Denzel Washington for the performance.
Directing and
he directed
all sorts of stuff. Yep.
And he had, this was a play, which if I had not known that, I still would have figured it
out. Yeah, he probably would have figured it out.
that Denzel Washington, I guess, had done on Broadway or somewhere for hundreds of performances. So he knew the dialogue quite well by the time they put a camera in front of him. You rented this on Amazon and generously allowed me to watch on your dime. And I think I sent you a message partway after the movie had started, and I said, I'm 11 minutes in. Is Denzel Washington ever going to stop talking in this movie? It felt very theatrical at times. Like, seriously, the first at least 11 minutes is him talking nonstop. And I'm like, is this guy have a mental problem? What is going on? He doesn't stop talking. I found that very exhausting. And it was very... oration. It was very making profound declarations of this and that and telling you how you're going to do it. And there are elements of live theater that I don't like, and the reasons I don't like it are because they're very theatery, they're very phony. And some of that, when you try to make a movie based on a play, you either try to reel it up, so to speak, and add a lot of locations and maybe make the dialogue a little less like you're playing to the back row, or you try to be very true to the play, and it comes off not working.
Right.
And at the beginning of this movie, I had a hard time getting into it because of that. I'm like, he's never going to stop talking and pontificating on every aspect of life, and this just feels fake. It, the whole thing, all the interactions, I felt like I was watching a play. Eventually, I got used to it, and it, I think it calmed down a little bit. Basically, the story of the film is he's a working-class guy who had hopes and dreams that he pushed all aside for to, you know, make money for himself, for his wife, for his family. And you find out as the film goes on what these dreams were and what he could have been great at these things, but he chose not to to pursue them to be more realistic in his life. And it sort of sings the praises of the everyday working man who sacrifices, you know, a happy life for a stable life,
so to
speak.
It felt to me very much like modernized Death of a Salesman.
Kinda. Yeah. That didn't occur to me at the time, but yeah. So in the end, I thought it was moving at times toward the end. Overall, it felt, fake isn't the right word. I don't think anybody was bad
forced.
In it.
It felt it's, forced.
It's one of those things where my personal dislikes come into play. Like with the Kong movie last week. A lot of people love that movie. A lot of people are totally cool with it. It did enough things that I don't like about movies in general that it bugged me and I didn't like it.
Okay.
And Fences is the same way. It does enough about plays or films based on plays that I don't like that ultimately I was like, this isn't that great. But it is, it's not a happy movie at
right.
all.
That's true.
There are maybe a couple of smiles over the course of the 2 hours of this film, but it's mostly pretty depressing and sad. So yeah.
I've always said, since the show's been on, that I'd pay, you know, $12 to watch Denzel Washington read his laundry list. This kind of put that to the test, because you're right. I was sort of, you know, getting in, and he's got such a mellifluous, wonderful voice that I love listening to it. But yeah, after quite literally 5-10 minutes, I'm getting to wonder what's going to happen. My understanding is that this was his directorial debut, and if not, it's one of his earlier films.
And I've always found, it's not all the time, but most of the time, if an actor is directing a movie, they're very actor-y movies.
Right.
Where there's
Absolutely.
A lot of pontificating and emoting, and they don't always know how to put it into drive.
Right.
So,
anyway. Well, but again, for that, visually in particular, I think that's clearly what separates motion pictures from theater. Is in theater, we're stuck right here from a single perspective, and that's okay. But this media, medium, didn't address the material well enough. The camera certainly could have moved around a lot more, and I think maybe that's why, especially early on, Woody Allen's done a bazillion movies, and he's in his own films, but he's done so many others. I think it might have benefited Denzel. Not that he takes notice of what I have to say, but was to either act in it or direct it, one of the two, because I think there's too much for a single person to have to think about. And so I think the directing aspect, with the exception possibly of performances, I thought the direction of camera and editorial style and things like that kind of went by the wayside. He's, I think, probably the greatest actor alive today, so I'm looking forward to more from him. I was kind of disappointed in Fences, thought it was kind of long and drawn out.
Speaking of long and drawn out,
which maybe like 90 years or so long, or 120 years or so long, Chris Pratt and, oh, you're over here, sorry. Chris Pratt and Jennifer Lawrence decide to take a little trip. But in order to do this, you got to take a big long snooze during it, but they wake up in the middle of it. They're like 30 light years away from Earth, and they got 90 years left of just hanging around in this ship on which they are passengers.
To ensure it runs smoothly, the following are three vital tips to help you find a travel agency that is right for you.
And they all looked like they were from Planet of the Apes, basically.
When I first saw this, both with the trailer, that trailer, and going into it, I thought, and you and I were just talking about this, I thought this was a romance in space. Holy cow, they're stuck. What are you going to do with nothing to do for 90 years?
Yeah.
This film is a lot deeper. And I say that knowing the cliche term, that the cliche attitudes about film that that evokes. But I do think it is. I saw this the first time, and this makes it look like the two of them just kind of wake up through problems and stuff like that. That's not what happens. I'm not going to get much more into it, but what really does happen makes us dislike one of the characters, makes me wonder how either one of them can get along with the other. In retrospect, after seeing it the first time, I was thinking more and more about it, and, whoa, wait a minute, for the way it resolves at the end, whether it's good or for bad, that all that stuff had to happen, and it really comes together, and it's really multi-layered, and while it looks great, and it's got great sci-fi elements and great holy cow moments where they take a tour out in space and they're looking around. I just thought this was a much denser and deeper film than any of these trailers ever leads to. Now, you don't want to, I actually let Dan Mitchell, the radio station host, the radio host former, that does the radio version that I do, I'll keep saying radio as many times as possible, borrow my Blu-ray version of this. And when I handed it to him, he goes, oh no, not that one. And he thought it was Arrival. Not that really super smarty pants sci-fi. No. This is Jennifer Lawrence and I've been waiting to see that one. So I think they were afraid maybe to make it look as, for want of a better term, cerebral as it is. It's fun. It's a great romance movie. It's got some action in it. It's maybe a little bit too long.
Yeah.
I think you could have trimmed 10 minutes from it. And there are some science elements that I tend to worry about way too much, similar to some of the other sci-fi films we've seen in a few years, that for the most part, you know, that couldn't have happened, but you need it for the drama. So overall, the more I've seen Passengers 4 times already, and the more I see it, the more layered it is. But if you don't get it, all those layers and stuff like that, I still think it's an exciting, enjoyable film.
I also went into this thinking, it's a romance in space. This looks boring and fluffy. And I was so happy to find that there's a lot more going on in this movie than that. And this movie has seen a lot of people think this movie is terrible. Like, I've seen people writing it off as this stupid movie. I think some people have a beef with pretty people in movies. I don't have a beef with pretty people in movies as long as they can act and there's a brain in the movie.
Right.
And some people have issues with what one character does that sets the rest of the film
right.
in motion.
Sure.
And feels like the character is not punished enough for that, or that it's not treated as morally reprehensible. And it is. I wonder, did they watch the movie or not?
Because right.
That was one of the things. I'm like, wow, this movie has a lot more going on upstairs than I thought it would. And I think we're in a nice spot right now where we're seeing a lot of sci-fi movies that have a brain in their head and can still be entertaining and
right.
a little bit populist. Like, you know, you had Arrival, Oblivion, which was, you know, arguably not a genius of a movie, but I thought was pretty cool.
Okay.
And a lot of other things are coming along, and this is maybe more...
Interstellar was a huge hit last year.
Interstellar.
So, yeah.
There have been a lot. Sci-fi doesn't just have to be lasers and stuff blowing up in space.
Right.
Though they do generally find a way to work an explosion into all of it. This movie at the end gets a little bit superhero sci-fi, which right. I was a little disappointed in. I'm like, oh, this is... Now you're becoming a dumb... action movie, but I really liked how much thought is, you know, this person is, it's one of those movies that puts you in the shoes of the person highly effectively, where, you know, Pratt wakes up too early on this space trip, and what does he do?
Right.
How does he survive? What does he do with his time? How does he maintain his sanity? Where's it going to go from there? And they spend a good amount of the movie on that. It's not just like the first 5 minutes. So it really makes you wonder, what would I do in that situation?
Right.
And that kind of what would you do continues throughout every other section of the movie.
Film addressing that. What would we do?
Yes.
We're sitting there as audience members thinking that. And then when the film addresses that, that's a smart film.
Yeah, and even when things seem, as you said, things seem to be all sunshine and lollipops in the film, you and the film knows that it really isn't.
Right.
And that, you know, I really thought Passengers was really good. Beyond that, it's gorgeous to look at.
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh boy, in the big screen, it was gorgeous. I'm a big fan of sci-fi corridors. There's actually, somebody did a blog post once about sci-fi corridors, and it was all just stills of corridors from different sci-fi movies, and they have really nice corridors in this film. And this is the ship design, there's some cool effects here and there. It is an incredibly small cast, to the tune of what, 4 people?
4, I think.
Maybe 5 by the time the movie's over with?
Well, yeah, 4, because we have the animated, the robotic
right.
guy, so Yeah, and then we see like two or three people in the very last shot of the film.
So there's almost nothing. It's a very, it's like another Castaway almost, but with a larger cast. Away. So I like Passengers quite a bit. Your mileage may vary. A lot of people hated it, but you know, we are two people who did not. Up next, here's a film I didn't see, but let me take a whack at it based on a sentence on a piece of paper that is, let me just itch my nose a little bit. A psychic apparently works with an FBI investigator to hunt down a serial killer. And in doing so, they and all they love and hold dear will hopefully find some solace.
I call every week. It gives me something to look forward to. I get the answers I need. It works.
So I hadn't seen trailers to this. I didn't, to my knowledge, it wasn't released in theaters. So I'm going into this thinking, oh, holy cow, Anthony Hopkins needed some money. But it's one of those that there are some... I think Hopkins and Colin Farrell are two, I think you can call them movie stars. Jeffrey Dean Morgan, I like a lot. You see him in a lot of different things.
Current villain on The Walking Dead, so he's a TV star thing.
And Abby Cornish, I think is her name. So here's the setup. Morgan and Cornish are FBI agents. Morgan clearly has a history with Hopkins, who is a psychic. Apparently a very successful psychic who had worked with the FBI and many... other iterations, but something in his past, 2 years ago happened. This isn't a big surprise. His daughter dies. His like 23-year-old daughter or something like that. And it just devastates him. It breaks up his marriage. His wife is separated. So he's just cut off all ties. Morgan finds out about this serial killer who is going along and he's puncturing people's vertebrae and killing them instantly.
Do they have a name for him? Do they call him the piercer or something?
Something like that. I don't think they do. But so I don't want to give away too much as to who the killer is, why he's doing it. But it's kind of like he's doing it to help these people. In his mind, he's doing it to help these people. And so we keep enumerating and we find more and more out about why he's doing it and how he's doing it. Once we find out who he is, it was a surprising twist to me to find out some of the things that as Hopkins is going along. And again, he's psychic. So there's the kind of traditional way that we all expect he touches somebody. And then editorially, these things come in. So we start with that, and I'm thinking, oh, really? It's just going to be about that? But then the film moves along very cleverly with some very clever camera work and lighting work to get into even deeper aspects of whatever psychic powers he may have. So that got even more interesting about halfway through. Then about two-thirds of the way through, we meet the killer, and we find some very interesting things about him. I was just bowled over at the way this movie progressed. It kind of sucked me in early on, thinking this is going to be a real mundane, run-of-the-mill thriller. And I ended up really liking Solace. It's not up there on Passengers list with me, but boy, for this week... we've got another one to talk about afterwards that I liked a lot. I thought it was a really good week for video, and Solace was right up at the top of the list for me.
As I was saying off the air, and because it was so brilliant, I'll repeat it again. It's always disappointing to me when we see a movie like this that was not given a theatrical release for whatever reason.
Right.
Maybe Anthony Hopkins isn't considered a bankable name anymore. It's Lionsgate. They're not huge. They don't want to risk as much money. It's always disappointing when you see something that's really effective and really good that wasn't given that shot. Moreover than anything, putting something in theaters, more people are going to see it that way initially.
Sure. I don't know,
probably in the end, more people will see it on video. But if something has been in a theater, it raises the awareness of it.
Sure.
And you wish, you know, these movies that you love that are really good would have been given that shot to be to go the distance, to be legit, than just to be shuffled off onto the endless, you know, stream of online. I may take a shot at that if I have time.
Sure.
Because I love a good piercing as much as the next guy.
Yeah.
And speaking of films that pierce the heart and the soul and the emotions,
and
we have one more film to discuss.
We have one more film to discuss. Will Smith is in his, annual? He does a couple every year, I think. But Will Smith plays the CEO of a company, strangely enough. And we're having tragedies in lives and things like that a lot. A horrible event sees Will Smith's young daughter taken away from him by death. So it's not just she was taken away. And he stops, he doesn't communicate at all. He withdraws completely from his company. All of the people around him who work with him and love him as well, good friends, are really concerned because the way he deals with it is he writes letters to love, death, and time. And he's trying to work through this, but won't talk to anybody until the moment that, strangely enough, love, death, and time actually show up to have a conversation. And they try to convince him that with all of the horrible things that are going on, there still is collateral beauty.
Queen mong jowa, nagluto ng fiesta, may sports pa. Anong silbi niyan? Wale para sa toothache mo.
So this has a great cast. Will Smith, Michael Pena, Helen Mirren, Edward Norton, Kate Winslet. It just goes on and on. And
hacks.
Hacks. But they couldn't afford real actors. Yeah. My older son just despised this movie. Thought it was sappy and predictable, and I can see that. For some reason, this hit me right at the right moment. I love Will Smith. He's terrific. He kind of walks through this because it's not really, while it's about him, it's about all of these other elements that come into play. And there's a question about, I won't give that away, when these three muses, or whatever we want to call them, time, love, and fate, and death, come to talk to him about things. You know, how did they get his letters? These are his letters. Holy cow. And so he has to deal with that. I don't want to give away a whole lot. If you're thinking it looks sappy or something like that, it certainly has that potential. But this struck me at the right time. It was right before the holidays. And this is really redemptive. You know, it talks about how it gets to the point where, yeah, he only had his daughter for 4 or 5 years or something like that. I forget how old she was. But, you know, they revel in those 4 or 5 years. And there's still wonderful things, even in the, and maybe this is a good time to be talking about this, even when the world looks like it's about to go to hell, there are still things to enjoy. I thought Collateral Beauty, as I recall, it was certainly at the top of my list, if not tops, of my favorite films of last year.
I forgot we have to review our best and worst episode again. I did not see it. It was at Keen Cinemas on a week where I think I was away. I just couldn't. Okay. That was one movie too many for me to see that weekend. But I trust that you enjoyed it very much.
Oh, I did. I enjoyed it enough for both of us.
I have nothing substantial to say about that other than it's in color and apparently in focus, which are two things I love
that's good.
In film. Color's debatable. So that's all that was new this week.
Yep.
I managed in my sick bed, literally, to watch about 6 movies on Saturday.
Okay.
None of which I'll discuss today for their sanity's sake.
It's becoming more and more difficult for me to catch up on all these films because spring training has started.
Oh, see. Priorities.
That's sorry.
Priorities.
Speaking of priorities,
yes,
we will not be here next week, will
we? Because my priority is being out of town. It's to watch movies.
Yes, to watch movies. So.
The Alamo Drafthouse is hosting Hudson Horror, which is a show that I go to in Poughkeepsie a couple times a year. They're doing a shortened version of this, which is...
strange time for them to do it.
It's wonderful. March Madness. It's... Candyman, the first of the Candyman films, which I saw in the theater and liked. The Vampire Lovers, a Hammer horror film.
Yeah.
And a movie called It Came Without Warning, which is an early 80s horror alien movie. They're showing those with vintage trailers
Never
and prize
it.
Giveaways
okay.
and stuff. It's Martin Landau's in it, as a matter of fact.
Oh, is it Marty? All right, good
Swamming.
For him.
And perhaps Jack Palance might be as well.
Okay.
So they're showing those, and then the next night they're showing a movie called Double Agent 73. I will not explain what this movie's about, but if you know what it's about, hey, this is that movie on a big screen. And then the next night they're showing Barbarella on film.
Oh, my goodness.
So those three in a row, it's a 4-hour drive for me to go, so I decided I would just go and make a weekend out of
sure.
it. So that's what I'm going to do next weekend.
Good
I won't
for you.
Be here on Monday to do a show. So the next time we see you will be another catch-up program.
Yep.
Which will be
2 weeks from now, and we'll be talking at the speed of sound.
Breathlessly about
yes.
a dozen or more movies that we've seen, which will include Power Rangers, a movie called Life.
Life, yep.
And
Chips.
Probably Chips.
Yep.
And anything else we can cram in that
exactly.
amount of time. So do you have any words of wisdom for those people?
None whatsoever.
Tide them over and fill their souls for 2 whole weeks without
Go Cubs.
Oh. Fun. Go ahead. They may. Until then, I'm Mark.
And I'm Tom.
And we are
the Cinemaniacs.
We'll